Genesis chapter 4, the verse I wanted to look at was just there, verse 1. The Bible says, "And Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived, and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord." And the title of my sermon tonight is Conception. Conception. It's kind of an interesting word. It's actually found three times in the Bible. But even just different forms of the word, like conceive, we see here in this verse. But what does it mean to conceive? If you look up in the dictionary, it says that conceive means become pregnant with a child. Now, it's interesting that the dictionary can get this right. But, you know, most people in America can't get it right. It said, hey, if you conceive, you're pregnant with a child. Yeah. It's not just some, you know, tissue. It's not just some organism. It's not just some fetus or whatever name they want to come up and make it. It's a child. Right. And to conceive means become pregnant with a child. And even the word pregnant, I looked up that word in the dictionary just to see what it said. It said, having a child or other offspring developing in the body with child, or young, as a woman or female mammal. So it's kind of interesting. It said one of the definitions of pregnant is being with child. That's a phrase that you'll see a lot of times in the Bible describing someone who's pregnant, saying that they're with child. So you can see that the Bible, you know, it uses words really well. It uses phrases really well. That's why most of the words in the dictionary, I mean, a lot of times they line up with what the Scripture says. If we just look at what the words say, we'll get a good definition of what the Bible's saying. Now, obviously, you can't just put all your trust in the dictionary and man. You know, the Bible will define itself. But it's written in English, and we can use the English, you know, language to understand what God gave us. So the first point that I want to kind of make, or the first thing that I want to talk about, is that there's a false doctrine that not all children come from God. There's a lot of teachings that would teach that God's not the author of life, that He's not giving every child in conception. You say, what are these doctrines? What are these people believing? Well, just the theory of evolution. I mean, the theory of evolution doesn't say God's the one that gives life, that God's the reason that there's a child in the womb. But it says in Genesis 1, look at Genesis 1, verse 24. It says, "And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beasts of the earth after his kind, and it was so." Now, I'm not going to preach against evolution tonight, but the Bible makes it clear that everything brings forth after its own kind. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 14, if you would. You say, what does the word kind mean? You know, is that like species? Is that, I mean, what does that really mean? I think sometimes, you know, it might be difficult to see the word kind in the Bible defined, but I think Deuteronomy 14 kind of gives us a definition. But the Bible makes it clear that everything brings forth after its own kind. You don't see different animals transforming into other kinds. We don't see the elephant become a, you know, giraffe. We don't see a bird turning into a turtle. We don't see these things in our life. And you have to believe, you have to have faith in the fantasy and fiction of evolution to believe that. Right. But the Bible says that everything brings forth after its own kind. Let's see where these kinds are divided. Look at verse 11. It says, "Of all clean birds ye shall eat, but these are they of which ye shall not eat. The eagle, and the ostrich, and the osprey, and the gleed, and the kite, and the vulture after his kind, and every raven after his kind, and the owl, and the nighthawk, and the cuckoo, and the hawk after his kind, the little owl, and the great owl, and the swan, and the pelican, and the greater eagle, and the cormorant, and the stork, and the heron after her kind, and the lapwing, and the bat, and every creeping thing that flieth is unclean unto you. They shall not be eaten, but of all clean fowls, ye may eat." So we see a couple times there, look at verse 13, it says, "And the vulture after his kind." Verse 14, "The raven after his kind." Verse 15, "And the hawk after his kind." We see again even in verse 18, "The heron after her kind." So the Bible gives us of all these different birds. And I mean, the vulture and the raven, I mean, they're definitely different birds, but they look kind of similar. But God's saying these are different kinds. They, you know, a vulture's not going to get a raven. A raven's not going to get a vulture. We see from the Bible, everything brings forth after its kind. So even, you know, from the theories of evolution, they say microevolution, they see all these adaptations. We see kinds are very specific. God made very specific animals. He made very specific birds. And we can kind of get a little bit better definition of a kind. And, you know, if you look through the Bible, there's a lot of animals mentioned. I mean, it seems like almost every animal that we even know of today in its form of a kind is pretty much mentioned in the Bible. I mean, we see all kinds of, you know, birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things mentioned in the Bible. It's incredible when you start tallying all the things, all the animals that are written in the Bible. But it's very clear from the Bible that evolution's false. But evolution would say that, you know, the thing being grown in the womb, it just comes by some process of everything getting better and it being changing and it changing species. And you were a Homo sapien, now you're Homo sapiens sapien, and then you're going to be a Homo sapiens sapiens sapien. I mean, they just keep going on. And, this philosophy was dangerous. That's why Hitler did what he did. He didn't think that the Jews were even the same kind or race. He's like, they're just animals. And, you know, Hinduism teaches that the lower caste system, that they're just animals. And we see that this thought process, this belief is in the whole world. It's been throughout history, and it's a wicked and evil thought process. But even people would say, well, life comes from a lab. I mean, today there's a lot of advances in technology, and they say, you know, we can create life in the lab, and we can take the sperm of a man and the egg of a woman, and we can create life. But they're not creating life. We know that. Nobody can create life. Go to Exodus chapter 8, except for God. And, you know, they say, well, maybe we can't do it in the lab. We just need billions of years. We just need a really long time. I mean, I know this is a rock, but if you give it a billion years, this rock will just turn into life. You got to believe in that. The Bible doesn't say that a rock will turn into an organism, and the organism will turn into a fish, and the fish will turn into, you know, a reptile, and just so on and so forth. No. Of course, they have to believe that it's billions of years. They have to believe that that's what creates life. Time. Time doesn't create life. You know, we see most things in this world get worse after time. But in Exodus chapter 8, look at verse 17, it says, and they did so, for Aaron stretched out his hand with his rod and smote the dust of the earth, and it became lice in man and in beast. All the dust of the land became lice throughout all the land of Egypt. And the magicians did so with their enchantments to bring forth lice. But they could not. So there were lice upon man and upon beasts. Then the magician said unto Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. And Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he hearkened not unto them, as the Lord had said. So we see even the foolish people today, you know, these magicians are smarter than them. They were saying, look, if something that's inanimate, like dust, can become life, even just a small form of life like lice, they're like, this is just God. I mean, there's no other way to explain it. It's God if life is produced.
Right.
But you know, there's people today, and they're so foolish, they're so ignorant on purpose of what God's done, that they're willing to say, no, this rock, you know, turned into all the life we see today. All the humans we see today, all the animals just came from this rock, rained on the rocks, and the rocks turned into soup, and soup came alive. You know, quotes from Ken Hovind. If you don't know anything about evolution, just watch some of his creation seminars, and you'll find out real quick that evolution's dumb. It's foolish. It's ignorant. It's ignorant of the Word of God. But the doctrine that I really wanted to kind of focus on or look at is there's this doctrine out there called the doctrine of the serpent seed. So they don't believe, you know, that life necessarily came from nothing or life just evolved. But they actually believe, there's people that believe this really weird and wicked false doctrine that Satan literally has begotten children. That not people aren't from the Lord only, that they also are physically begotten of Satan. And they believe that Cain was not begotten of Adam and Eve, but rather of the serpent. That the serpent had actually begotten him. You say, where did they come up with this weird junk? Like, how in the world did someone come out of that? Well, they didn't get it from Genesis 4. Because Genesis 4 clearly said, and Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain. So first of all, it's Adam and Eve according to the Bible. But then secondly, the verse says, I have gotten a man from the Lord. Now we could just close our Bibles, go home, and say, all right, everybody's begotten of the Lord. Let's just go home. I mean, that's simple. But there's all these weird false doctrines. You say, where's it coming from? Well, interestingly enough, it comes from a text called the Gospel of Philip, which I had never really heard this. I'd never really read it. You know, I heard some people say, man, these apocrypha books and these extra scripture books, usually they're just trash and they're just garbage. And they're, you know, you read it and you're like, who could come up with this dumb stuff? I've never read anything more, you know, more moronic, more foolish, more blasphemous in my entire life than the Gospel of Philip. I mean, this thing is beyond trash. This thing is beyond garbage. Every single line is so ridiculous. I mean, it's like a drunk demon Catholic wrote this tract. I mean, it's just full of just heresy and foolishness and nonsense. Because one moment it's Catholic, one moment it's demonic, and the next moment it's just stupid. But we see it says in the Gospel of Philip, it says, "He who has been created is beautiful, but you would not find his son's noble creations. If he were not created but begotten, you would find that his seed was noble. But now he was created and he begot. What nobility is this? First, adultery came into being. Afterward, murder. And he was begotten in adultery, for he was the child of the serpent. So he became a murderer, just like his father, and he killed his brother. Indeed, every act of sexual intercourse which has occurred between those unlike one another is adultery." Now, there's a lot to unpack in that little garbage paragraph that I just read to you. But he's trying to say, look, the first thing that ever happened was adultery. And somehow the serpent, you know, beguiled even that way, and she bare Cain. And they say, that's why he became a murderer. That's why we get, you know, these evil and wicked people in the world. It's called the serpent seed doctrine. And it's false. There's no part in the Bible that says this. The Bible makes it crystal clear that man comes from God, that man begets man, too. In the latter part of this verse, it said, look, when things of that are not alike one another, that's adultery. No, that would be, you know, lying with a beast. That's unnatural is what the Bible says. It's not adultery, but it's worthy of death. It's abominable. But you can't beget anything because everything brings forth after its own kind. Again, we see an attack on the idea that things bring forth not after their own kind. It's kind of similar to the doctrine some people believe that the sons of God in Genesis chapter 6 are like actually fallen angels mating with humans. No, the Bible makes it very clear that the angels of God, you know, can't be the sons of God, or the fallen angels. He says, to which of the angels that he said at any time, thou art my son, today have I begotten thee. No, you can't be the son of God unless you're a man that's believed on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Right.
But it's very clear that this trash, that this filth, you know, is just lying. And you say, well, how do you know that this isn't the word of God? How do you know that this isn't true? Well, just read it. I'm going to read for you a couple more pieces of the Gospel of Philip. I don't recommend that you go read the thing because it's just horrible. It's just filthy. It constantly just blasphemes the Holy Spirit over and over. It calls the Holy Spirit a female. It calls the Holy Spirit a liar. It does all kinds of weird junk. But here's some other stuff that it says. It says, a Gentile does not die, for he has never lived in order that he may die. He who has believed in the truth has found life. And this one is in danger of dying, for he is alive. He says, look, when you become born again, in their words, you're in danger of now dying because you're alive. That's just the foolishness of man. That's not the preaching of the word. They're teaching that you can lose your salvation, that you're in danger of hellfire if you become alive, if you know the truth. That's just a false doctrine. It says in John chapter 11, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? It says in another place of the Gospel of Philip, it says, light and darkness, life and death, right and left, are brothers of one another. They are inseparable. Now, what kind of dumb junk to say light and darkness, they're one another, and that they're inseparable? The Bible says, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Even a five-year-old would be like, that's just dumb. I mean, you know, he's likening, if you said light was darkness or darkness was light, the same as sweet is for bitter. Now imagine I set before you two glasses. One glass is full of apple cider vinegar, and the other one's full of apple juice. Now, only a fool would say that they taste the same. No, obviously apple cider vinegar might have some good health benefits, but it doesn't go down real nice. It's not real sweet. It's real bitter. You know, and I don't want to even try and taste it. I'm sometimes like, well, I'm kind of sick, but that's just too bitter. But you know, apple juice, I love apple juice. I love juice. I love fruit juice. It tastes so good. You know, this analogy, some people might not be able to recognize. But if I were to set before you like some milk chocolate and then an apricot seed. Now, maybe you've never had an apricot seed, but it's literally the most bitter thing I've ever tried in my entire life. I mean, it's just kind of awful whenever you try it. These things, you know, it's interesting. There was a book written by a guy said, A World Without Cancer. He had studied some tribe in Africa where none of them ever got cancer. And he was like, well, if there's people living on the earth today that don't have cancer, let's look at their lifestyle and compare it to ours and see what's different. And they noticed that they ate all these apricot seeds, which contain the vitamin B17. And they noticed that the vitamin B17, it's arsenic, but it's covered in sugar. And they said, well, since cancer attacks sugar, I guess maybe scientifically it makes sense that these cancer cells are attacking these, you know, sugar-coated arsenic cells, and that arsenic would damage and kill the cancer. You know, I'm not a medical professional. I'm not saying that this is a cure for cancer. I'm not saying that everybody should do this. But, you know, if I had a loved one or had somebody, I'd probably try it. And you know what? I've actually eaten plenty of apricot seeds in my life. But they don't go down real sweet. No one's going to be confused. No one's going to take a bite of that and be like, ooh, that's great. I can't wait to have another. But, of course, milk chocolate you like. But this foolish and, you know, moronic gospel of Philip is saying that light is darkness. No. Light is the difference of darkness. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. The Bible says in 1 John 1, it says, this then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. The Bible makes it clear there's a distinction between light and darkness. That's why it says in Genesis chapter 1, he divided the light from the darkness. There's a division there. They're different. It's not hard. A five-year-old can tell you that black's not white, that bitter's not sweet, that light's not darkness, that good's not evil. Right. They understand that. They understand that getting, you know, money from their parents is not the same as getting a punishment. I mean, it should be first grade. But, you know, these foolish people, these people that want to believe these false gospels. I mean, if you can read that junk and think that's the God of the world, the God of the universe. I mean, the God of the universe is stupid if he wrote that junk. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, look at verse 14. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Look, they're not brothers. Light and darkness aren't brothers. They're not inseparable. That's just another lie from this junk. This junk constantly blasphemes the Holy Spirit. It says in one verse, it says, God is a man-eater. For this reason, men are sacrificed to him. Before men were sacrificed, animals were being sacrificed, since those to whom they were sacrificed were not gods. I mean, what in the world? God is a man-eater? How is that the scripture? How is that comforting? No, my Bible says that God is love.
Right.
My Bible says that for God so loved the world. My Bible says that he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come unto repentance. God is not a man-eater. That's just disgusting. That's blasphemous. There's so much junk. This one just blew my mind, though. It said, the children a woman bears resembles the man who loves her. If her husband loves her, then they resemble her husband. If it is an adulterer, then they resemble the adulterer. Frequently, if a woman sleeps with her husband out of necessity, while her heart is with the adulterer, with whom she usually has intercourse, the child she will bear is born resembling the adulterer. Now, what in the world kind of junk is this? He's saying, if a woman has an adulterer that she sleeps with all the time, but then she still kind of out of necessity lies with her husband or knows her husband, that whenever she bears a child, the child's going to look like the adulterer because the adulterer loves her. Not because of the fact that he knew her, not because of the fact that they were having relations, but because he just loved her. What a false and wicked doctrine to say that, you know, oh, it's just who loves her. No, they're teaching all kinds of false, wicked doctrine. Teaching that adultery comes from who loves you. So I guess Satan just loved Eve. And then, oops, Cain just came out. The serpent seed. No, the Bible makes it clear that Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bare a son. And that we know that conception has to take, what has to happen? Two people come together, they know each other, as the Bible. They become one flesh. That's how conception begins. Go to Genesis chapter 4 back. Go back to where we were. You know, with this weird doctrine, this weird book, the Gospel of Philip, it even has a place in it where it kind of alludes to the fact that Jesus and Mary of Magdalene, Mary Magdalene had kind of a relationship or something. You know, it just says in one, like, one other verse is something like Jesus gave her a kiss. And then from there they draw, oh, they were married and they had kids and blah, blah, blah. Obviously the Bible doesn't even say that. And the Bible says even if, you know, he were, it would be like just a normal thing or a greeting. But the Bible doesn't even say that. But they go on from this one little, like, part of the text, and they made a whole movie out of it, a whole book called The Da Vinci Code. The Da Vinci Code comes from the Gospel of Philip. Comes from this junk, from this trash. And so many people read it, so many people believe this junk. I mean, 80 million copies of the book have been sold. And it's been translated into 44 languages. You say, why do you reject this junk? It's nothing like this book. I mean, anybody can just write just a little bit of lies. But can you write, you know, 66 books that completely line up, that have no error, that are just the wisdom of God, that doesn't have any imperfection? No. That's why I believe the Bible. I believe it by faith because it's not even close to the trash that tries to compare itself. I mean, the Gospel of Philip, I mean, I think Dr. Seuss makes more sense than that book. I mean, it's just junk. But my first point, really, there's really only two points that I want to focus on, is the fact that God gives physical conception. So let's first focus on the fact that God gives all physical conception. It's not, you know, the serpent seed. It's not evolution. It's not created in a lab. It's not by some magician. I mean, it's only by God. And in verse 1, it says, look, I have gotten a man from the Lord. We see from this, from the Bible, this is a common theme. So let's keep, we're going to turn through Genesis in a couple places. Go to Genesis 21. I'll read for you in Genesis chapter 29. The Bible says, and when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. So there, look at verse 21, look at verse 1 in chapter 21. It says, and the Lord visited Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did unto Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age, at the set time of which God had spoken to him. So the Bible even says that God, the Lord visited Sarah. I mean, he's actively involved in the idea of a child being conceived in the womb. He's there. He's present. He's the one that's making it happen. And even in her old age, even when it's not even physically possible. I mean, it was not physically possible for Abraham and Sarah to conceive. But God just made it happen because God's the one that's in control of all conception, all physical conception. Go to Genesis 30. We'll look at a couple other places. I'll read for you in, let's look at verse 2. It says, and Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel. And he said, am I in God's stead? Who hath withheld from thee the fruit of the womb? So we see Rachel. I kind of read for you that Leah, her womb was open. She had four sons before, you know, it was the first four sons came from Leah. Eventually, Rachel kind of gave unto her husband her handmaid, and she started having children by her handmaid. But Rachel was barren. She didn't have any children. And that made her really angry. Because in the Bible, not having children is a curse.
Right.
Not having children is a shame. Not having children is not fulfilling your purpose that God intended for men and women. God intended for women to multiply, to fulfill his purposes. I mean, if Adam never knew Eve, none of us would be here. I mean, it doesn't make any sense if people were just like, well, I don't know if I should have kids, I don't know. In today's world, most people, they're like, I don't know if I should have kids. I don't know if I want kids. Look, the majority of people have a God-given desire that's burning inside them to have children. Unless they squander that, unless they squish that, that's just a God-given, you know, desire that we all have. And Rachel's angry. She's like, man, I want a kid. And she's complaining to her husband. He's like, look, what have I done? I've known you. I've lied with you. Am I the one that's keeping you from getting pregnant? Am I in God's stead? No. God's the one who opens the womb. God's the one that had withheld her the fruit of the womb. It's not the man. It's not the woman. Now, obviously, the man and woman have to be taking their part. But God's the one that brings the fruit. Look at verse 6, it says, and Rachel said, God hath judged me, and hath also heard my voice, and hath given me a son. Therefore called she his name Dan. The Bible says in verse 6, look, Rachel, you know, said that God had judged him, and also heard his voice, and hath given me a son. Therefore his name is Dan. Now this was by this wasn't actually born by Rachel, it was born by her handmaid. But she's like, look, you know who gave me the son? God. Look at verse 17. Go down a little bit further. And God hearkened unto Leah, and she conceived and bare Jacob the fifth son. Turn, if you would, to Psalms chapter 139. Psalms 139. Look, this is so important. This is an important doctrine that you get in your mind, that God is the one who opens the womb. Because this is a thing that takes place for most people. I mean, most every single person, you know, is going to experience either having children or the struggles of having children or the thought of wanting to have children or not having children. I mean, it's just a reality. And we need to know why people don't or do have children. It's because of God. And if we want to encourage somebody or if we want to bless people, because today there's a big battle. There's a big fight when people decide, hey, should I have kids? Should I continue to have kids? Why should I have kids? I mean, the Bible makes it clear that God's the one giving. And that's going to be really important understanding why we should. But look at Psalms 139, verse 13. It says, for thou hast possessed my reins. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect, and in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me. O God, how great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee. We see that God takes a really special importance on the creation of a child. That he has a lot of thoughts on the creation of the child. That it's a great miracle. That he's forming this child. He's writing all of his members. He's fashioning this child. God is a very divine work in the creation of every child, of every human, of every person. He's thinking about this person. Go back to Genesis, if you would. Go back to Genesis 38. But we see Rachel was barren. She was barren for a while. But eventually God did open her womb. In Genesis 30, I'll read for you. It says, God remembered Rachel and God hearkened her and opened her womb. You know, when women are barren, it's only for one reason. It's because God's allowing it. God wants that. God's not blessing them with children. It could be for a multitude of reasons, but we need to understand that it's God that's deciding for this woman to be barren. For this couple to be barren. And I'll read for you a couple of verses. It says in Deuteronomy chapter 7, thou shalt be blessed above all people. There shall not be male or female barren among you or among your cattle. When God was giving the commandments unto the children of Israel, he said, look, if you're following all my commandments and you're living how I want you to live, you're in the promised land, none of you will be barren, ever. God always wanted to bless people with children. It was never God's will to withhold children. He's saying, look, if you're following my commandments and you're in the land that I promised you, you're not going to be barren. Now, obviously, I'm not saying that just because someone's barren that they're just in this great sin or they're doing this wicked work. Maybe God's long-suffering for that person. Maybe it's that person's will in life to not have child for a while. But the Bible makes a lot of promises that even the barren will bring forth children. And we see that in the life of Hannah. We see that in the life of Rachel. We see that in the life of a lot of women, that they were barren for a long period of time. I mean, we're talking years and years and years. When we think about Rebecca, she had been married for 20 years before she gave birth unto Isaac. I mean, 20 years. Can you imagine? I mean, I can't even imagine if me and my wife were trying to have a child and it had been like 2 months. I mean, it's just been like a few months. She would already be kind of like, oh man, we're still not pregnant. Oh man, I really want to have a kid. I mean, then a year, then 18 months, then 2 years, then 5 years. I mean, it gets pretty depressing when you haven't had a child. Look at Sarah. I mean, she was like almost 90 years old and she hadn't had a child. I mean, some people have to wait a really long time, but it's God's will that we'd have children. And not every single person will. And I believe, you know, it's possible that it'd be God's will that someone wouldn't. But he made a promise unto the children of Israel, if they would keep his commandments, if they were doing right, there wouldn't be any barren in the land. And on Psalms 113, I'll read for you another place. It says, "He maketh the barren woman to keep house and to be a joyful mother of children. Praise ye the Lord." He's saying, look, even the barren woman's still supposed to keep the house, though. You know, she's still supposed to be in the house, keeping the house. And you know what? Eventually she'll be a joyful mother of children. I'm going to read you verse 24 of Genesis 38, where I had you turn. It says, "And it came to pass about 3 months after that it was told Judah, saying, Tamar, thy daughter-in-law, hath played the harlot. And also, behold, she is with child by whoredom. And Judah said, Bring her forth, and let her be burnt." Now the interesting thing is even we see in the first story, it was, who was born? Cain. Who was the first man born? Cain. Now, was he a great person? Was he a godly man? No, of course, he was a wicked person. And the Bible says in the spiritual sense, yeah, he was the son of Satan. He was a child of the devil. He was a murderer, just like Satan is. But Jesus Christ still makes every single man. And even if you come into a bad circumstance, some people say, well, maybe Cain, you know, his parents sinned or they did some wicked thing, so that's why he's bad. Maybe he was just born bad. Maybe he was just born wicked. Well, we see here in Genesis chapter 24 that there was a child born by whoredom. And yes, he was born by incestuous, you know, whoredom as well. It was a father with his daughter-in-law. I mean, this is not a good sin. This is not a good thing. The Bible had said in the Old Testament law that if you had known your daughter-in-law, that you should be put to death. I mean, it was a big sin in the Bible. You'd say, oh man, this kid's destined for something terrible. Well, lo and behold, she has twins. And one of the twins is named Pharez. And this twin is in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Think about that for a moment. A father has relations with his daughter-in-law, and God chooses that man, that child, to be in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Just proving the fact that it doesn't matter where you came from, or maybe it was a bad situation in which you were born. Look, there's a lot of bastard children in the world today. And I'm not excusing it. I'm not saying that it's good. But all things work together for good to them that are the called, according to His purpose. You know, you can come from a bad situation and still do big things for God.
Right.
God used a lot of wicked people. God used a lot of wicked circumstances to do great things for Him. I mean, just think of the 12 tribes of Israel. I mean, it's a mixed bag of family. I mean, it's got, you got two wives and two concubines, and you got all these people. You got like brothers that want to murder, brothers that were murderers for sure. I mean, you got all kinds of weird people. That's the 12 tribes of Israel. Their names are written in stones forever in the new kingdom of heaven. God can use bad situations. He can use bad sins and still have big things for God. Go to one more place. Look at Ruth chapter 4. So I'm really just trying to drive in this point that God's the one that brings forth the conception. He brings forth physical conception. We need to get that solidified in our mind and just know that it's all God. Ecclesiastes chapter 11 said, "And thou knowest not what is in the way of the spirit, nor how the bones do grow in the womb of her that is with child. Even so thou knowest not the works of God, who maketh all." God makes all. He fashioned everyone in the womb. He curiously wrought their members. He had many thoughts unto that child. You can truly say that God loves all the children of the world. I mean, he formed and fashioned this child. He loves it. He gives it life. Look at Ruth chapter 4, verse 13. "So Boaz took Ruth, and she was his wife. And when he went in under her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bare a son." You say, well, maybe it's just the man and the woman, they come together, and they do the conception, and then God just kind of grows the baby inside. No, it says very clear here that the Lord gave her conception. Where does conception come from? From the Lord. This is one of the three places that word's used. It's titled my sermon, "That Conception is of the Lord." You know, I was talking with one of my family members one time. We were kind of talking about having kids, and they were asking me to say, "So, you know, how many kids do you think you want to have?" This is a common question among the heathen, common question among Americans.
Yeah.
"So, yeah, how many kids do you want to have? One, two, maybe three?" "You don't have four, do you?" I heard a guy talking at work. He said there was some guy that they knew. He was like, "Oh, Joe, yeah, he has four kids." And he was like, "Whoa, is he Mormon?" He says, "No, he's really Christian." I was like, what does that mean? I mean, just four kids? I hope someone can say that I'm really Christian because I have a bunch of kids. That would be great. But when I was talking to my family member, you know, I said, "Oh, you know what? I don't know. We're just going to keep having them. Just keep them going. As many as God will give me." Because guess who gives me children? God.
Amen.
And I don't want to tamper with that. Why? Because children are always a blessing. Children are always a blessing. It's never a bad thing. It's never a negative thing. In our world today, people think it's bad. People think it's negative. That's why there's so much abortion. That's why there's, you know, people just wanting to give their kid up for anything. I mean, I'm not necessarily against adoption, but there's so many women that are just willing to just give up their baby. Give up their baby for money. Give up their baby for time. Give up their baby for selfish desires. People don't want to have children. They think it's negative. They think it's a curse. They think it's going to take away from their life. No, it's one of the best blessings of God to have a children. Children are always a blessing. Go to Psalms chapter 127. It says in Proverbs 13, it says in verse 22, a good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. Look, a good man's thinking about his kids and their kids and their kids. He's constantly thinking of the kids. He's constantly taking in consideration his children. Why? They're a blessing. It's what we should do. It's part of our life. A good man's thinking about his children's children. Right. Bible says in Psalms 127, verse 3, lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. I mean, who doesn't want a reward? I mean, I want lots of rewards. So guess how many children I want? As many as God will give me. It's always a reward. The first kid's a reward, the second kid's a reward, the third, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth, you name it, they're all rewards. And you know, there's some great men of God, there's some great people, great servants of God. They had a lot of kids in the Bible. You have the 12 tribes of Israel, you have some men that had 14 children named in the Bible. You have a lot of great men of God, had lots of children. Look at verse 4, it says, as arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are the children of the youth. Look down at Psalms 128. It says, thy wife shall be as a fruitful vine by the sides of thy house, thy children like olive plants round about thy table. You know, it's a blessing to be sitting down at dinner and just have a bountiful, you know, olive plant. Just have all these buds of children all around the table. Have your wife being a fruitful vine, not being barren, not being a dead vine. No, producing. That's one of her roles. That's one of her jobs. Because children are a blessing. You know, I don't want to lose any blessings of God. That's why, you know, when I'm talking to my family member and I'm saying, I want a lot of kids. He's like, oh man, kids cost a lot of money. You know, if you have a bunch of kids, you can't spend as much time with each one. You can't, you know, if you're going to do homeschooling, it's going to be really hard to teach them all. They're probably all going to be dumb. He said, it's going to be a lot of effort. It's going to be a lot of work. I mean, there's just so many negatives that he kept bringing up. And I kept thinking, you know what? I love my kids so much to death. There's nothing that you could ever convince me to say I wouldn't want them. And I even know that's true for him. I know if he had another kid, he'd love him to death, and he would never wish to not have him. That's why every single older person I've ever met in my entire life, every time I ask them this question, I say, hey, do you think you wish you'd had more kids? They always say yes. They always say, I wish I had more kids. I don't care if they had one kid, zero kids, 20 kids, 500 kids. Doesn't matter. They're like, you know what? I wish I had another one. I wish I had another son. I wish I had another daughter. I wish I had twins. I wish I had triplets. I wish I had so many more children. Because children are always a blessing. And we should take the wisdom of the elderly to know, hey, if they are saying they all want to have more kids, maybe when I'm younger, and it seems like it's maybe harder or it's not as popular, I should take their wisdom and realize maybe I should have more kids. Maybe I should do what I should ask for God for more blessings. The gift of God is eternal life. I love that gift. If children are a gift, if children are a blessing, if children are a reward, why would I not want that? I want as many gifts and rewards and blessings from God as I can get. I mean, it's better to give than to receive, but I want to receive every gift that God has for me. That's why it's important to understand that God's the one that gives them. It's not me. It's not just my wife. Now, obviously, we play an active part. You got to do your part. That's why my second point is God gives spiritual conception too. He doesn't just give the physical conception. He gives the spiritual conception, right? Go to go to Galatians chapter 3 for me. So if God gives the physical conception, he also gives the spiritual conception. And I think a lot of people in this church know that. That's why it says in 1 Corinthians, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. 1 John says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even though that believe on his name. The Bible says in Luke 8, now this is the parable, the seed is the word of God. How do people get born again? By the seed. And guess what? The seed's got to get planted. The seed that's planted is the word of God. God's the one that begets conception physically and spiritually. It says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. By the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. 2 Corinthians says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. God makes a new spirit man. He quickens the spirit. All things become new. I mean, you're born again, not by corruptible seed, but incorruptible, by the word of God. You know, I can't give you an incorruptible seed. I don't have that. My seed's corruptible. But God's the only one that can give the incorruptible seed to be born again. Galatians 3 says, verse 7, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. Look at verse 26. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Now just as physical and spiritual birth, we see that there's still got to be an active part. You don't just lay around and have kids. You don't just, oh, I'm not going to get married, I'm not going to do anything, I'm just going to have a bunch of kids. Oh, I'm just going to lay on the couch and I'm going to get a bunch of people in the Lord. No, you got to do your part. God uses man in the equation, but God's the one that gives the increase. We see that he said, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. You know, me and my wife, we know each other just as Adam knew his wife, but God's the one that gives the increase. God gives the increase physically. He gives the increase spiritually. You know, some people think, well, like this gotquestions.org. You know what? They have this button on their site. It says, hey, if you prayed this prayer, click here, because you got saved. And they just look, they say, oh, 100 salvations. Oh, 10,000 salvations. Oh, 50,000 salvations. They're just sitting on the couch, doing nothing, just thinking of more false doctrine, reading more of the Gospel of Philip.
That's right.
And they say, oh, I've begotten all these children. Look, 50,000 salvations. No. You got to go out there and plant, and you got to water, then God will give the increase.
Right.
You can't just sit on your tush and have them click a button. That's not salvation.
That's right.
And guess what? You got to know your wife to have conceived and have a child. You got to do your part, but God's the one that gives the increase. You know, there was, you know, this got questions. It's just junk. It just makes me think of the 450 prophets of Baal against Elisha. Where they just, every article I've ever read is just full of false doctrine. Or something's perverted or wrong. I mean, even if you just take aside the fact that they don't use the King James Bible, they're not ever anything, it's so shallow, it's so weak, it's just garbage. Because it's just false doctrine after false doctrine. That's why they have a button on their website. Oh, click here if you got saved. That's so stupid, it's so foolish. But we see that the conception comes from you working hard, and the Bible even makes it clear that it's kind of like physical birth, spiritual birth, in a lot of ways like spiritual birth. In Galatians 4, it said, my little children, you can look verse 4, chapter 4, verse 19, my little children of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. So he likens the fact of spiritual birth being like physical birth, of a travailing, of a struggle here. And I think in the spiritual birth, the idea of conception is really kind of one with being born again. That we don't see that there's this long waiting period of being born after you've been conceived. No, it's kind of like an instantaneous quickening, you know, conceived and you're born again. But we see that the travail is what? Giving the gospel, trying to overcome the false doctrine, trying to get the person to believe. We see that a woman really struggles in her birth. You know, the Bible talks about that struggle afterwards that the woman doesn't even remember. You know, when she gets the child in her hands. All the struggles, all the affliction, she doesn't even remember it anymore. I'll read for you in Revelation chapter 12, it says, and the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Satan hates the seed of God. Satan hates the woman. Meaning what? The one who bare all the children. She bare man that she got from the Lord, and they kept to bear. And they kept bearing, and they kept bearing. And we're here today. We see that we came from the woman. We come from woman. We all were born of a woman. Every single one of us. These sodomite reprobates don't reproduce. You were born from a man knowing a woman, And God gave the conception. God gave the increase. God curiously wrought you in your mother's womb. He had special plans for you. He had so many thoughts of you personally. Can't even count them. Can't even count how many thoughts God had just making you. Isn't that wonderful? But you know, there's some people that are the sons of Satan. How do you get there? Well, it's not from the conception. It's not from, you know, the man and the woman coming together. That's God. We see that the children, you know, they slowly get corrupted. Go to 2 Samuel chapter 23. We're going to have to hurry for sake of time, but I'll read for you in Matthew chapter 13. It says, "He answered and said to them, He that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels." We see that Satan is sowing his seed. Now, it's not with woman. It's not a physical birth. Satan has no physical children. He only can beget spiritual children. How does he do that? Well, he sows his, you know, his seed. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 23. Look at verse 6. It says, "But the sons of Belial shall be all of them as thorns thrust away, because they cannot be taken with hands. But the man that shall touch them must be fenced with iron and the staff of a spear, and they shall be utterly burned with fire in the same place. He that commits..." So we see there that these sons of Belial, they cannot be, you know, touched. They're just like thorns. What do you do with thorns? You can't do anything. That's why the sons of Satan, that's why those that are called reprobate, there's no hope. They're just a thorn. All you can do is just burn them. And guess what? All the sons of Satan and all the reprobates will be burned. At the end of the world, they're going to gather the wheat and the tares. And the tares are going to be burned. They're preserved to be burned. You can't touch it. You can't help it. You can't do anything with it. It's just prickly. It's just horrible. It's just rotten. You just got to burn it. You just got to get rid of it. In John chapter 3, it says, "Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. For his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God." When you're born of God, you can't, in your new man, commit a sin. Because the new man, behold, all things are new. You're begotten of God's seed. And God's seed can't sin. There's no darkness in him at all. It says, back up one verse, I didn't have you turn there, but I'll read for you verse 8. It says, "He that committeth sin is of the devil." So now don't get confused when the Bible's saying he that commits sins, because we've all committed sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But he's talking about in your spirit. Look, if you commit a sin, you're of the devil. "For the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." Look, those that would sin are going to be cast into hell if they don't get born again. And their new man, which won't sin because they've been born of God. In verse 10 it said, "In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that we should love one another, not as Cain, who is of that wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew him? Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous." So we see we go all the way back to where we got Cain. Now Cain didn't start out as the serpent seed. He didn't start out as being a son of the devil. He didn't start out as being a son of Belial, of being a reprobate. No, he was begotten of God. He was conceived by God. Eve got a man from the Lord. But how did he get there? I think the first way that people can get there is by murder. That's one of the seeds that sown Satan's seed that sows. Satan sows the seed of murder. And people that become these great murderous people, they're bloody and deceitful men. The Bible talks about this as just a roadway into becoming a rebel, into becoming some wicked, evil person. Obviously, because you commit murder doesn't mean you can't be saved. Doesn't mean that you can't be forgiven. But it's just a dark road unto becoming reprobate, unto becoming rejected, unto becoming one of these sons of Satan. Turn to John chapter 8. So I think one way that Satan sows his seed is by murder. In Jude chapter 1, I'll read for you. He says, "Woe unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain, and ran greedily after the heir of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Kor. These are spots in your feast of charity, when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds they are without water, carried about of winds, trees of fruit withered without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. The Bible says being twice dead, this guy's a reprobate. He's not just dead physically, you know, because of his first sin. He's dead spiritually. He can never be born again. Why? Because God's just rejected him. He's a thorn. He's just going to be reserved to be burned. But he said they went in the way of Cain. I think the second way that Satan sows the seed of becoming his child is just through the love of money, through desiring money. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all of them. When people just start becoming really covetous, when they're just desiring money, when they're just chasing the things of this world, it's going to cause them to go to a dark path, go into the murder. And when you got money, you got murder and the love of money, man, you're getting really dangerous. You're getting really on a dark road. You're getting in a scary path that's not leading to the light. Look at John chapter 8, verse 44. "Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." I think the third way that people just dive in to becoming a son of Satan is false religion. So in fact, these Pharisees, they were believing in false religion. They believed their works could save them. They were willing to justify themselves. And you know, if you take a guy who's a murderer, who has the love of money, and is steeped in a false religion, I mean, this guy is just running towards Satan. He's taking all of the seeds that Satan's laying for him, you know, in this world, and he's chasing them. That's going to cause him to become a son of Satan. You say, how does someone become a son of Satan? Well, I'll read for you in 1 Samuel chapter 2. It says, "Now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. They knew not the Lord." Look, you can be saved from any sin. You can be saved from your sins. But if you decide not to know the Lord, and you're chasing all these wicked and filthy and disgusting sins, you can become a son of Satan. You can ruin your life. You can be twice dead, as the Bible says it. You can become a son of Satan. Not by birth. Not by conception. Not because of the sins of your parents. Not because of the bad circumstance upon which you were born. Because you choose the path to not know the Lord, to reject the Lord, to hate the Lord, and then to chase money, to chase murder, to chase false religion. Makes me just think of, you know, Catholic priests. I mean, man, they're just constantly in false religion. Man, there's so many Catholic priests. How do you even got the Holy Wars? The Holy Crusades? They were going out just murdering people they didn't believe their false religion.
That's right.
And they were just capturing all the money. They were just filled with reprobates. The Catholic Church throughout history has been filled with reprobates, and the sons of Satan have always been murderers. Cain was a murderer. In Judges chapter 20, the sons of Belial, they murdered the concubine. The Pharisees, they murdered Jesus. The two sons of Belial, you know, in the Old Testament, they murdered Naboth by lying about him, by saying that he had blasphemed God. They lied about him. The sons of Satan are always full of murder. That's why in Romans chapter 1 it says, being filled with all unrighteousness, and says that they have murder as one of their sins. They're just constantly wanting murder. Don't be deceived. The sons of Satan, they love murder. I'll read for you that last piece. It says, "And set two men, sons of Belial, before him to bear witness against him, saying, Thou didst blaspheme God and the king. And they carried him out and stoned him that he may die." I mean, these sons of Belial, they're willing to lie under oath, under the perjury of their own. Because if they got caught lying, they were going to be put to death. They were willing to put their life to the test just to kill somebody. That's how much they love murder. They just want to murder so bad, they're willing to go great lengths. In Acts chapter, I can't remember the chapter, but it's like somewhere in the 20s. Paul, you know, they wanted to kill Paul. And certain men, they made an oath saying, "We won't eat or drink until we kill Paul." I mean, these people are going at all lengths to commit murder. We should avoid murder. We should, thou shalt not kill. The Bible makes it clear that these people that are bloody and deceitful men, they're headed towards being a son of Satan. You want to be a son of Satan? Love murder. Love money. Love false religion. But we know that God is the one who's actually in control of the conception. He's the one in control of the physical conception. He's the one in control of the spiritual conception. But we got to do our part. God's not just going to bless us with children automatically. God's not just going to bless us with spiritual children automatically. We got to go out and preach the word. We got to sow the seed. Man has to know his wife, and we have to preach the gospel. Because all life is valuable. When God was making that baby in the womb, he thought it was valuable. He had so many thoughts about it. He curiously wrought them. We should think that all physical life is valuable, and all spiritual life is valuable. We should not have any other thought or mind that this person just valued. And we should see that it's a blessing of God to have children. God makes it clear. I mean, how many spiritual children do you want to have? Do you want to be limited in how many people you get saved? How many people you win to Christ? We should have the same viewpoint for our physical children. To say, you know what? I just want as many physical children as I can possibly get. Because they're always a blessing. Throughout all times in history, I mean, basically if you go back 100 years ago, everybody thought having lots of kids was great. It's just in this wicked and adulterous nation, and these perverted freaks that want to limit the number of children. They want to limit the number of blessings that God can give you. But why don't you make it, why don't you purpose in your heart to decide, you know what, I'm going to let God control all of my physical and spiritual children. All of my children, they're in God's hands. And I'm going to let God control conception. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you, God, that you're willing to give us so many gifts. The free gift of eternal life. Thank you that you're also willing to give us other gifts and blessings in this life and rewards. I thank you so much for all the children in this world that you love and value. I pray that we'd have the same, you know, admiration and love for all the children of the world, that we want to get them saved, that we want to preach them the gospel, and that we'd also, you know, if any man desires to have a wife, that he would be blessed with many children. And he'd never be discouraged by the world, by the lies of Satan, that he'd have that child, and not only physically, but then he'd also get him spiritually, that he'd get him saved. And I pray that we would be wary of those that would chase and seek after becoming a son of Satan. That we know there's wicked and evil men, and we should beware of those men. Thank you for this church and everyone in this room. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.